We're going to give you kind of a crash course today in the nuts and bolts of how to get up and running with HINTS, all the way from identifying your topic of interest and coming up with a research question, all the way through to doing the analyses and coming up with your final story. It's my pleasure to, my name is Alexandra Greenberg. I'm a cancer prevention fellow here at the National Cancer Institute, and I've spent the past year working intensively with the HINTS management and research teams, learning to how to get rolling with this. So I thought that with our team, we might share this kind of insights that we came up with as we had someone who's relatively new and novice like myself getting started. So our first speaker today will be Dr. Brad Hesse, who's the chief of the Health Communications and Informatics Research Branch. And he'll share with us the history of HINTS and a 10,000-foot overview of what the content that is covered by it is and what the goals are and where we're going in the future with it. So without further ado, Dr. Hesse.
Great. Thank you so much, Ellen. And thank you for all of you for coming today. And for those of you that are going to be watching this on, I think, our webinar. So we have a contingent at FDA, I know, is watching this. And just so that you know, we're going to archive a lot of this, so that we're going to have up on the HINTS website. Other people in the future can go back and look at this. So when you ask a question, your grandkids someday will go back and find that and say, damn, they were brilliant, those guys. What was going on here? I want to give you just a quick overview of what the Health Information National Trends Survey is. Many of you have heard about it. Some of you have already worked with the data a little bit, but kind of where it came from. It looks like I get to move things with a button. Oh, see, isn't that cool? This is this new communication and information technology. Well, that's where this came from. So you have to recognize when the Division of Cancer Control and Population Sciences was first formed, we were right in the wake of a couple of things. First thing that we were in the wake of was in 1993, a switch where we knew the public health efforts, communication efforts in particular, were paying off in terms of getting people to quit smoking and then finally reversing that trend in lung and bronchus cancer. That was very important to us. It was also a time when we were nearing a point where human genome was being documented. Its completion would be about 5 years off when the division was formed, but we knew that that kind of technology would be hitting the public sphere as people understood what genomics was even about. And it was also a time after 1993, where this whole thing called the World Wide Web was experimented with. And we thought, you know, this might have legs. There might be something where people could understand how new communication technology might affect what they do in cancer control and prevention. So the proposal was that we needed to understand with all of this technology as much about how to communicate risks of something like molecular risk and genetic risk. We needed to know how to do that, and we didn't know much about how to do that at the time. We said, as Richard Klausner, our director at the time, said, now, we know more about how to calculate these risks than how to communicate them. So we needed to start tracking that. We held a meeting. I say we, it's the royal we, because I actually wasn't here at the time and got recruited after this happened, but held a meeting where a bunch of experts looked at the possibilities ahead for us in the division and said, we think that the opportunities in terms of this new information environment are going to be tremendous. But it's going to come with some risk because we don't know, this is an experiment. We don't know what the World Wide Web is going to bring. We don't know what information seeking is going to bring when it comes to people going online and preparing for their oncologist meeting and bringing these stacks of data to their oncologist. So we need to track that. So they proposed that, that NCI fund a national surveillance mechanism on communication, which was a big thing. It would be focused on communication for cancer prevention and control in specific, but because a lot of these changes would influence what was going to happen across the entire department, then a lot of folks would be able to benefit from the data that are produced. So that was the purpose of this, see if we could create some kind of tracking mechanism to see how people are responding to the information environment. Some of you know from the Division of Cancer Control and Population Sciences, we base a lot of our organization around a framework that was proposed by Barb Reimer and Bob Hyatt, which they stole liberally from Canada. And the framework is that we would make investments in fundamental research, in intervention research, and in surveillance research. And we would then bring that together with a lot of other smart people to see if we can create applications and improve program delivery. That was sort of the purpose of this. HINTS falls really well in this notion of creating surveillance research. So, and it is an experiment in surveillance research on the communication level and the health information technology level. And health information technology in 1999 was something that people didn't use. It didn't roll off the tongue the way it does after meaningful use. So we came right at the right time to kind of look at some of this stuff. I put in your in the packet a picture of the framework that we had published back in the early foundational article from the Journal of Health Communication, because I want you to kind of understand what we were thinking of at the time. So recognize when we were in a world of broadcast media, we thought a lot about what it meant to communicate in one way, in one direction. So we do a lot of awareness campaigns. That was the big thing, was the Katie Couric effect, right? But what was happening, we discovered, in the world of internet-mediated communication is that we all of a sudden had not just push, but we had a lot of pull. So people all of a sudden were seeking information and getting frustrated when they couldn't find it, or coming to the NCI and discovering that the stuff they did find was too technical to understand. So we built our framework around the notion that we wanted to understand how people were listening to awareness messages, but also where they were going to look for information, especially across these many channels. So we asked questions about channels, and we have a lot of factors around those channels that we're trying to measure and trying to understand. We want to know as much as we can about the person who's coming in looking for this information so we can tailor to their needs. So we ask a lot of questions about the individual and their predilections, what they know already, what their attitudes are, knowledge, attitudes, and behaviors. And then we put all of that onto a foundation of structural characteristics. Or we talk a lot about, many of you saw Nancy Krieger's talk yesterday about social determinants. Something we care about is how social determinants create gaps in knowledge or belief. And that's some of what we're going to do. We're going to use the respondents to give us their perceptions of the context in which they're embedded. So that was the framework. Our very first survey we administered in 2003 and brought the data back in 2003. We used at that time a sampling frame that was a random digit dial. This was in the days when you could actually do telephone surveys. Oh, those were the days. That was such a long time ago. And so we did that in 2003. And in 2003, we did have a special oversample of Spanish speakers, which we could do during the screening process as we reached out through this list-assisted random digit dial technique. It was a computer-assisted telephone interview. And if you were to go down and go onto the site and load those instruments, you'll see that they were set up for a telephone interview. And that has certain modality characteristics, as you can imagine, because it requires the individual to depend on recall memory rather than recognition memory. We did the same thing in 2005 and in 2007. But in 2005, we did a small experiment with a web survey, which didn't work very well, and found that in that frame, going to the web in 2005 was a time for a general population survey that we were losing people through the cracks. And so we said, that's not going to work for us. And others have replicated that same effect. So in 2007, we said, but we do have to do something about the falling response rates in random digit dial. And Westat, who is our contractor on this, and David Cantor in particular, who's worked a lot with people at CDC on the behavioral factor surveillance system and all of these things, he said, you know what people are discovering, believe it or not, sometimes old school becomes the new school. And he said, we have a new, more comprehensive postal frame where we can send to houses and households actual paper-based surveys. And we said, well, that's interesting. Talk to us about it. Why is that so important to us? And he said, well, think about it. If we're losing phone lines anyway, as people go off their landlines and start using mobile phones, that's part of the sample that we lose that coverage. So this would give us, we think, a better sample. And it turns out that now getting something in the mail, and as many of you know, we included $2 bill, which is, we did some experiments on this, and that seems to stand out because it's so unusual. You don't see $2 bills anymore. That people are inclined to respond to that. So we were getting better response rates. At least that's what was happening with the BRFIS. And we said, let's give it a shot. So we did a dual frame experiment. And I think Dr. Moser will probably talk to you a little bit about if you want to do trending, what to think about when you look at that dual frame. did a dual frame experiment, and we found out that the postal frame did in fact give us a more robust response rate, and we tested out modality effects question by question. Most questions held up pretty well across the modalities, but questions, as you can imagine, that were dependent on recognition instead of recall could actually do better in the postal. Others where we have other little effects, like if you have if you're expressing an opinion, you tend to do that in a more inhibited way on the telephone, in a less inhibited way on postal. So we did a lot of exploration into that, but we decided to commit to that postal frame. We moved into HINTS-4, and what we decided to do in HINTS-4 is we decided to change the frequency because so much was changing. This was at the beginning of the HITECH Act, remember from the stimulus package, and the HITECH Act, the Health Information Technology for Economic and Clinical Health Act, that was causing people to go online and start to use hospitals' portals. That was a brand new beginning of that. And we had the Affordable Care Act. So there was so much that was happening in the world that we wanted to increase the frequency. So we did four cycles, and all those four cycles are now made public and are accessible to this group to start getting into, and we can trend across those cycles. And we did a special module that will be made public in June of this year, funded by the FDA. And I had to ask Dr. Blake, who's been really in charge of this thing, what the sample was on that. Can you remind me?
Well, I told you.
I know. Oh, you forgot. I wrote it down. I didn't bring it with me. 3787. Okay, I think that's right. So sorry about that. I had a TBD on that one. HINTS-5 now has been approved. We have, since HINTS-5 has been approved, we're going to go through cycles just as we did with HINTS-4. So we're working right now on the package to the Office of Management and Budget for Clearance, and then we'll have four administrations, over the course of about 3 to 4 years. All right, so that's that. The HINTS program, when we got inside, we said, oh my gosh, if we do this right, and this is at the beginning of open science conversations, if we do this right, there's no way, looking at each other, Kelly and Rick and I looking at each other, that we can do all the analyses on this to do service to what could be, what could benefit the American public with these taxpayer dollars. So we committed to an open science philosophy of creating a program that would make the data available to community members such as yourself. And it's a decision we've never regretted. We've loved every minute of the way. I think we have something like 250 publications from a broad community. Many people are cancer prevention fellows who come in here, get dirty with the data, and then go out and then teach their students how to work with the data. So we have a very large community that's forming to support that. We have statistical manuals that people have worked on here right in that back row. We have a book by Hampton Press. We have a number of briefs that we've been delivering over time. Now, because of the program that we've been able to develop, other parts of the government are depending on it. This is an example of how Healthy People 2020 is looking at our data to confirm what's happening with the use of internet for health communication. And you can find publications on that. We're part of what now the CDC is referring to as health situational awareness. It's a complement to the other kinds of surveillance tools that we have in our toolbox, a complement to registries, a complement to other kinds of public health surveillance, but we're a health survey that fits within that group. Because it's a complement, we can juxtapose our data with other data and learn some interesting lessons. And this is an example of how we looked at a question about belief in the relationship of smoking to cancer, and finding a group of folks right around Appalachia that seemed to show a lot of disbelief in that relationship. And then taking that and comparing it to incidence of lung and bronchus cancer and mortality rates, and finding quite a bit of an overlap, which has been compelling to people. We're using it to track policy goals. So when the HPV goals were announced by the President's Cancer Panel, we certainly were on top of that and been tracking from the very beginning of the vaccination, the usage and awareness of HPV. So it's been fascinating to watch. We also are looking at quality goals. This is an example from our health care delivery research program. That program has really emphasized the notion of putting together better treatment summaries. And so we're asking people about their usage of treatment summaries. and we can use it that way. We can use it to support regulation science, known here as regulato science. I guess it got hidden by the tobacco, sorry about that, sign here. And this is a lot of what Dr. Blake has been helping us with, and we're going to hear some this afternoon, I think, or this morning, later this morning, from Hesse, on how we're looking at products in that special module. We can, and we're also using it now to track new legislation by the department. In fact, we have an infusion of dollars from the Office of the National Coordinator for Health Information Technology to really see how, in fact, patients are going to start using these tools that are being developed to connect them to their health records. And we have a lot of work on that. So I just want to leave you with some caveats. Caveat emptor, you know, let's be sure that we're not overselling this. This is cross-sectional data. We sometimes will do path analyses just to see if it's consistent with our logical a priori thinking about things, but we can't really infer causality, so we know that. We have weighting procedures that you'll learn about. Be sure that you use all the appropriate weighting procedures when you make population estimates, but you are able to make population estimates, which is very important. We have guides for tracking trends over time, which is a very powerful component. Some people think about getting into just one cycle, but think about tracking over time. There's a lot we can learn about doing that. And be aware of the mode change that I mentioned from the Katie to the time that we went postal. All right, and in doing all of this, the community, I think the challenge is help us turn this data into the kind of empirical results and knowledge contribution that what we care about is to inform action. These briefs that we mentioned, these briefs we are using as a way of reaching out to results users. So we'll find some of the best papers that are being produced by communities such as yourself, and then we'll synopsize those, and it puts that knowledge from a dusty shelf into actual usage, and we encourage you to follow through with that. So that's it for the introduction, Allie, and now we're going to move to our next presentation, and I bet that's probably you.